Record on camera. Recording on phone. Take one. Science and technology are so important to our modern society. The question is often asked about why is the mission of the APS, which is to diffuse knowledge of physics, so important? We are committed to having our society be the best version of itself possible. And we live in a time when science and technology, engineering, and even mathematics has an impact on the quality of life of our fellow citizens, both in the country as well as humanity around the world. Physicists don't start doing physics to get prizes, and they don't start because mostly we don't think we're going to become millionaires. We start because we are driven by a passion and a deep love of understanding nature. It is important to recognize exemplary performance in physics for a couple of different reasons. One of the reasons is a celebration of doing physics and a celebration of the individuals who have performed the task that physics sets out for itself. And some of us perform this task at such a high level that we celebrate them with these sorts of prizes. And then finally, it sets in some young people's minds a fire that maybe I can reach that level of performance. And that excellence of performance is what we're after. The Valley Prize is a prize that recognizes an early career researcher. And this year, the recipient is Dr. Vedika Khemani. The impact of Dr. Khemani's work is in the realm of finding out new ways in which materials work. Dr. Khemani has made an extraordinary demonstration in this object called a time crystal. The kind of research that Dr. Khemani carries out is extraordinarily important for the future. We will need our technology to advance. This task is central if we're going to get more efficient, more robust, and even faster communication, having an enabling role in the future of quantum computing, as well as making sure that the future of device manufacturing and new technologies is brighter than it has ever been.
Up in India, and my dad is an engineer. He would be traveling a lot, he would be busy a lot, but he always made time for us to do math and physics together. I would find all the math problems that I could solve. I was a voracious reader as a child, so I read everything that I could get my hands on. I read Stephen Hawking's A Brief History of Time, and especially reading Hawking's book, it was just amazing to me that you could ask these really deep questions of the universe and be able to give concrete answers. I study condensed matter physics. My collaborators and I were thinking about how we could define phases of matter and phase structure away from the strictures of equilibrium thermodynamics, where all of our grounding, all of our understanding was previously based. And the Floquet time crystal is one example of a new kind of out of equilibrium phase of matter. This is a phase of matter that was thought to be impossible in the equilibrium setting, but has found this new life. Why a time crystal is really important is that it's this brand new realization of this many body phase of matter that can show you this cooperative motion forever. Okay, now we see that this brand new possibility exists. What can we do with it? Anytime we figure out something intrinsically new about how the world works, that almost always has far-reaching technological implications, and it makes life better for all of humanity. To really demonstrate that you found something new and special, requires a degree of care, right? You really need to convince the skeptic. You want pushback from the community, right? You want ideas to be tested and weathered. And it's in that dialogue, it's in that exchange that you can really crisply identify why is this different. Research is always hard, right? You're trying to look for something that has never been found before. So it doesn't matter what problem you're looking at. Every problem has a little jewel of discovery.
The Julius Edgar Lilienfeld Prize recognizes outstanding contributions to physics and exceptional skills in lecturing to diverse audiences. The recipient of the Lilienfeld Prize is Dr. William M. Jackson. Dr. Jackson has worked in a part of physics that sits on the boundary with chemistry. His work asks questions about how does the universe create the chemicals that ultimately go into the geology of our planet? How does the universe come to manufacture chemicals? That's one way to think about Bill Jackson's work. The ultimate sort of thing for Bill, however, is not just being a great astrochemist. He has dedicated decades to being an exemplar mentor as well as teacher. But more than anything else, the demand is a passionate belief that you, as an individual, can find a secret that the universe has buried, and you could be the first person to know that. And Bill tells his students, his mentees, all the time, you can be that person, because he has actually lived and become that person.
In Birmingham, Alabama, in the Smithfield projects, I always knew I wanted to be a scientist. I never knew what kind. The first thing that draws any kid into science, I think, is your curiosity about the world around you. I'm motivated by learning about new things and trying new methods. I'm an experimentalist first, but I like to do experiments that when I finish, I know that I measured something that will allow not only myself to measure things, but other people. Everybody thinks science is difficult. It is, in some respects. There's a lot to learn. But if you really want to be a success, you have to, like anything else, devote yourself to it. I'm most proud of is the originality I showed in two things. Using the tunable dye laser to determine the properties of free radicals. The second would be use of the ultraviolet explorer satellite to obtain the first spectra of a comet that is unobservable from the Earth. I mean, I've had a long career. It's like asking artists which painting he loves the best. And you love the stuff that you feel that you made original contributions to, that you didn't have to follow anybody else, but other people were following you.
APS Medal for Exceptional Achievement in Research recognizes contributions of the highest level that advance our knowledge and understanding of the physical universe. This, to me, is the goal for physics. Having an individual celebrate at this level must be an extraordinary affirmation to the decades of work could bring a small nugget to all of humanity as gifts from our discipline. The recipient of the APS Medal is Dr. Gordon Bain. Now, Dr. Bain is so famous that even when I was a student, I had heard of him. He has contributed to diverse areas of physics across nuclear physics, across particle physics, and condensed matter physics, and atomic, molecular, and optical physics. He is, in some sense, the all-around example of a physicist who isn't satisfied in making great contributions in one part of our field, but moving across a broad spectrum of activities in the field and making fundamental and important contributions to each. We often see physicists who work and create extraordinarily deep contributions in a particular area of physics. What distinguishes Gordon from many of our peers is the range, not just the depth of his contribution, but the range of topics over which his career has taken him. It is utterly extraordinary.
Just 1 second, my wife has something. Yes, dear? As a kid, I was always interested in things technical. For example, I built a lot of radios, some of which worked, some of which didn't. I also remember once my mother had got a pressure cooker, and not knowing how to do it, she at one point had the little jiggly thing off the top, whereupon a jet of chicken soup went up, coated the entire kitchen with chicken soup. And I thought that was absolutely marvelous. But I had no idea that there was a field called physics. Well, my basic research, looking back on it, has centered on understanding matter under unusual conditions. Very high energies, very high densities, and very high rotation rates, where different things happen. And so immediately a group of us began to study neutron stars and ask questions, what could we do to understand them better? And so we, in the beginning, did very naive things. We worked on possible states of superfluidity and superconductivity and calculated things like electroconductivity of the universe. And so I found myself thrust immediately into the conceptual designing of the heavy ion collider at Brookhaven. That was a long project. That was some 17 years before, from the first time we set the idea of the machine out on paper until there were the first beams. First beams were in 2000. What does good research require? I think having a very good critical sense of what one's doing, being able to choose problems well, being able to pay attention to experiments. One of the things I've always enjoyed was being able to find simple physical understanding of systems beyond just the mathematics. I think the other thing is that's been very important for me is knowing when I'm doing nonsense, but being able to see it through testing ideas from all different points of view, asking unusual questions, unusual limits, really eventually sharpens one's understanding of whether the answers are right or not. And I think that's certainly been a very big part of my approach in physics. A very important part of doing good physics, I think, is not being aware that you're doing good physics. I think the ability to do this comes from enjoying it. Being able to be a physicist and enjoy what you're doing is really, really a tremendous gift.